permit site of this direction would go in this very important search for a new superintendent. I want everybody to be free and ask any questions, if you would, please. We do have a presenter. I think we probably have three options of doing the search, all the mechanics of it in-house, a private search engine type thing, a group for the North Carolina School Board Association, which is, has developed a lot of expertise in this, but as soon as we get, if that's agreeable with everybody, we'll listen to what Ms. Schaefer says, and then we'll decide if we should decide to go that way. I think it's important that we take a vote tonight so that we could get started as soon as possible. All of you have some material she sent out, and I'm sure she's going to go over those in somewhat detail here. Appreciate you coming out tonight. We get to experience FaceTime on the big screen.
Mr. Chairman, if we have questions, should we hold them to the end, or?
I'll ask Allison what she wants us to do.
Okay.
This will be her presentation. My feeling was, I think in the past, she's experiences in Raleigh at those seminars have been that she's invited questions along when she went on. She's calling this man here.
I'd ask each one of them.
I'll give you all
to explain.
Why
you'll expect this money.
Thanks a lot.
And then, if they want it. Rig us up a straw man or scare car, sit down a seat, have us interview, put the school board, sign on. And it has to tell me a question. I said you get the same answer for the straw man down there than you do for me. You take that straw man, don't even get the sound thing of a house, put it up there. Don't bring it, have them down there of some sort. Just plan on doing that.
Thank you.
Hi, Allison. No sound yet. Here, can you hear us?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. It's fine. Thank you for arranging this. What's the weather like in Raleigh?
It looks okay for the moment. It's just supposed to start snowing anytime now. So thank you all for understanding my weather situation up here.
Hold on just a minute. I think we're not getting a good volume. Can we turn it up in?
It's up.
Up as far as it goes. Try again, Allison.
Okay, is that better?
I believe so. Danny, would it help you to go closer?
You want to take one of these?
Yeah, a little closer. We called the meeting order a few minutes ago. I did, and we all are on the same wavelength. We're happy to hear your discussion and proposals for what you might do for us in our search for a new superintendent. I'm just going to give you the floor. Do you want us to ask you questions as they come up or wait till the end?
I think it's fine to ask as they come up because that's what you're thinking about that issue around that topic. So that's fine. Thank you very much for this opportunity to talk to your board about our superintendent search service. I want to say, first of all, that you all know this is probably the most important decision that your Board of Education makes as in its duties, because you're going to choose who's going to be the CEO of your school system, basically. So it's a very important task. We at the School Boards Association are here to serve you. As you know, we're a membership organization that consists of all of the school boards in the state of North Carolina. And what we do is provide services to our school boards. So we are here to serve you as the Board of Education, and this is one of the many services that we provide to our boards to try to help you do your work. We have sent to you ahead of time, and I believe copies were made for you of our memorandum that describes our services, as well as several draft timelines and a booklet that is basically an informational booklet for you. We wanted you to have that regardless of what direction you go in with regard to choosing your services. I think the first decision you have to make is whether you want to do a search. Some boards choose to hire someone they already know directly and not do a search, so that's the first decision that you've made. If you have someone internally who you already know will take the job, I mean, I know that's happened in a number of places. Gaston County had a tradition of doing that, but this time they did a search. They did a search with us just in the last few months. So there are several good reasons to do a search. One is, even if you have folks that you already know, you may want to look around and see who else is out there, and it helps if you do choose an internal candidate. Ultimately, it makes it clear that that person is the best candidate. So that's another reason to do a search. And also, obviously, you want to look around and see who's out there and make sure you have the best candidate. So those things are very important. We are... what we believe our search service provides to boards is the very best service at the very best price. We have provided searches or helped with the administration of searches with over 75 of our 115 school boards for a total of 125 searches. Some boards we have helped with searches multiple times. This service was started 15 years ago when I came to the School Board Association. I had done searches as part of my work at Therrington Smith when I was a partner there. And I realized the School Boards Association did not have a service, and most state school boards associations do have a similar service. So I began this, and we started with a few a year, and we're now up to about 10 searches a year. I think we do about 75% of the searches in the state. There are a few that do it themselves. There are a few that do it through their local board attorneys, and there are a few that do it through national firms. We do think we are the least expensive proposition, and we're very experienced. We're aware of who's out there looking. We have contacts with everyone in the state, every school board, every superintendent we work with. So we believe that we also provide the ability to make sure that you have, you reach everyone you want to reach in terms of being, having a great applicant pool, and also being able to do reference checks and background checks, and provide you information about candidates that is relevant to your search. The cost for our search this year is $15,000 plus any expenses. Generally, we don't see these search costs going over $20,000. If you don't have us do it, somebody will have to do the paperwork and make sure, and basically we'll have some costs, whether it's a local board attorney or a private search firm. Our experience is, I know Charlotte used a search firm, and that was about $85,000, so that just gives you a comparison of an out-of-state search firm, what that might cost you, plus expenses for flying folks in from out-of-state to meet with you and all that kinds of things. So, again, we believe we're the very best. I've been doing this a long time. We also are part of a network of 36 state school boards associations that provide this service. So we also have a database of candidates that are looking nationally that we can access, so we don't just confine our search to North Carolina either. We believe our costs are significantly lower. We do not make a profit on this. It's just to cover our personnel costs and other costs that we charge for. Our service is unique in another way, and that is that we are very respectful of the Board of Education's role. Our job is to find you the best candidates and get you the best information so that you can appropriately assess the candidates. We do not screen or recommend candidates to you as many private firms do. We do not believe that is the role of anyone but the Board of Education. And legally, it's your role to make decisions about who you choose to interview and who you choose to hire. Again, our role is to help the process go smoothly, to get you good information, to give you the background information you need, to make sure you have a great pool of candidates. We do contact candidates that have expressed interest or what we believe might be a good fit for your board. But again, we don't even tell the board who we've contacted because we don't want to influence your decision. It is the board's role legally and ethically, I think, to do that, to make your own decisions. And so we're very respectful of the board's role. We do not intervene in the decision-making process or tell you who the best candidates are, in our opinion, because you all are the ones who are elected by your people to make those decisions. I've given you a list of the states that we or the school boards we've worked with. I've also given you some contact information of districts similar in size to you and in your area, such as Union County and Winston-Salem, that have used our services recently. And I encourage you to call those folks if you want more information about our services. What I wanted to do is just kind of go through with you the two timelines that we had sent, if you want to pull those up in your materials. We have sent two timelines, and I just want to go through the process that we recommend. And again, I will say this. We recommend a process based on our experience and what works well, but you all make the decision about how you want to change that process if you do. We also do draft documents for you, such as an application form, but there's a lot of opportunity to personalize that to your school board. And I'm going to just sort of talk about the steps that we see in a superintendent search process. And those are discussed in more detail in the booklet that we provided. So we federally believe the best amount of time to advertise is about 8 weeks. The smallest amount of time we recommend is 6 weeks. And we've given you two timelines, one that has 8 weeks of advertising and one that has 6 weeks of advertising. And we believe it's, especially if you want to have someone in place by the time your current superintendent leaves at the end of June, what we recommend you do is go ahead and advertise with a more generic advertisement form. And in the meantime, do community and staff surveys and input. And most boards choose to do that. As you all know on the board, because our personnel laws do not allow you to divulge the identity of applicants or information about them, but you want input from your staff and community, we think the best way to do it is to do an online survey that allows anyone who wants to comment on what they're looking for, what their concerns are about the school district, etc., that those folks have an opportunity to have input through an online survey. And also there is an opportunity to provide comment at your public meetings as you are required to do by law. So we recommend an advertisement period. The only deadline you really need to set in stone is your application deadline, because that's what you need to advertise. But we will contact the candidates. We will get the word out. We will help. We will do the advertising based on where you want us to advertise on your behalf, and we will basically try to get you as many great candidates as we can. Once the applications are due, it generally takes us about a week to process the applications. We do provide you some tools. We do internet searches of candidates, so you'll have a little more information about those candidates and what they provide to you. We also do what we call an experience chart that kind of summarizes for you what the credentials are for each of the candidates and allows you to kind of keep track of who's who. And then we send you the information we receive with those tools that help you process through that. We would come to your board meeting when you review the applications and meet in closed sessions and facilitate that meeting. But again, we do not recommend folks. We just help facilitate the meeting in terms of how many and what the process is. The board generally interviews between 7 and 10 candidates the first round. It doesn't have to be that many, but less than that, you may feel like you don't have as much choice as you like. More than that, you'll probably be overwhelmed with the number of interviews. But we have in these timelines, we have a range of dates for the first interviews. It's about 2 weeks. If you want to squeeze time out of either of these timelines, you could have your interviews toward the beginning of that range. And then after the first set of interviews, boards generally narrow the pool down to three, or three is the ideal. 2 to 4 is what we suggest, but 3 is the ideal, because if you only have 2 finalists left and one drops out or doesn't check out for some reason, then you may have only one choice to make. So that's not a choice, I guess. So in any case, we are there for the process. We facilitate the interviews. We will come, be available to get folks in and out, to make sure the candidates are there, to make sure that your privacy is protected, the confidentiality of the candidates is protected, because again, by law, that's required. But we do not sit in on the interviews for the same reasons that I was talking about before, which is, I think it's very important for it to be clear, it's the board's decision not to have other folks sitting in on the interviews. And then during the time between the first and second interviews, there's generally about 3 weeks in there for us to check the backgrounds and references and for you to do, you know, that kind of checking that we would help you with. And we want to be really, really thorough at this point. It's really important that you don't get surprised by any information that might come up. Once you decide on who you want, we would turn that over to your board attorney for contract discussions and negotiations. The board attorney, the board chair, often facilitate that at the direction of the board or within the parameters set by the board, and then you would make your announcement. Those are kind of the steps that most searches take that we think are useful. 2 interviews is a good idea. You don't want to just meet someone one time and decide on them unless you already know them well. And you need to be really thorough about your background checking. So I'll be glad to answer any questions. I know this is not the best format in the world. Hopefully that gives you what you need in terms of information. We believe we have a great service, and I will tell you that many of the boards that we work with, after they're done with our service, say, we just can't imagine doing it any other way. And I encourage you to check those references, because we believe that we here to serve you, and we try to serve you to the best we can. We will knock ourselves out to try to make you all happy and find someone that you feel satisfied with. With that, I welcome any questions.
I'll start off if that's okay. I just have a general question for clarification. Did you say you sent a booklet, or was it this memorandum?
Oh, you know what? I think we had planned to bring it with us, and we'll send it on. And I apologize for that. I have copies here for you, but they're in my house, not in your hands. There's a general booklet that just talks about the process, but it basically, I've just summarized what it says by going through the timeline, and I'll be happy to send those on if you think they would be helpful.
I think
it just talks about North Carolina law and what the process is, and you know, things about open meetings and public records and stuff you all are somewhat familiar with already.
I think that would be very helpful if you could go ahead and send it out. So if I understand it correctly, the only real date set in stone that we set would be the date for the open meeting to review the comments and so forth right now.
Well, no, the date set in stone would be the application deadline, because we would need to advertise that. There's some flexibility about setting that, the date of that, to receive the information about the surveys, and we would come, that's usually at a regular rescheduled board meeting, because you want as many of your public to hear the information as possible, and that is an open meeting. But that would be whenever your normal meeting is. I think we've targeted, looked at April 14 as the date that you have already scheduled meeting. And then the application deadline, we just need to advertise.
I noticed on the advertising, though, here, this is February 11th, if we should decide to contract for your services, does it have to wait until February 25th to start advertising?
No, in fact, this is what I would suggest to you. If you want to use our services, I would suggest that we come down as early as next week and get you started. We'll come with a bunch of documents, including an application form, a list of places we advertise, an advertisement that these will all be drafts and they'll need board approval. The survey information that we would suggest you use. We have several online surveys, several different options that we have used. And again, all these can be edited or changed by the board. But we would need to come to another meeting. And as soon as we come to that meeting, the next day, we can start advertising.
Everybody else join in. Cheryl, should we hand the microphone around or what? Who has a question?
Allison, I'm Kathy Falls. It's nice to see you here. I do have a couple questions because I'm concerned with the timeline. With Dr. Bowles leaving on June 30th, of course, both of these we would have to hire an interim because they have the start date July 23rd and August the 15th. So I want to know if we have wiggle room, if we could get the process started sooner, that we could have, because I have a couple of concerns, but if we hire someone that is already employed somewhere else and they have a 90-day contract, then we could end up even further out. Could you address that? Is there any way possible, if we found the perfect candidate, that they would be able to start by June the 30th, or is that an impossible task?
No, I believe it's possible if you get started next week, and then we could squeeze time. As I said, if you look at the shortest timeline, the one that says July 23rd, I believe we could squeeze the time out of that. So I think that if we advertise, if we started next week, that would save us a week from when this timeline is. So that would save a week there. If you look at the time the board reviews application, we might be able to shorten that a little bit. And we might, the meeting for initial interviews is a range. If we do it at the beginning, that's 1 week, basically. But we can squeeze time out of this, and might be able to squeeze a little time out of the period when we would check references and all that. So I think we could get the date to July 1. Now, if someone has a 90-day contract, that's going to be tough. But my experience is that most boards, when they find their superintendent is leaving, especially if it's in 90 days, that's not enough time to do a search. They generally release them within 30.
Okay. All right.
I think that it's doable if you guys get started relatively quickly.
Thank you.
Hey, Allison, this is Philip Glover. I was in the last search that y'all conducted, and I was very well pleased with the work that y'all did. Just for note to kind of help me out, how many current superintendent jobs are open in the state, and what is the cutoff date for them? Are they in line with us at the end of the school year? I was just thinking about competing, you know, would they take a job that would be available at the end of May or wait on this? I was just kind of wondering what their cutoff date is.
Well, a lot of folks are retiring at the end of June 30. It's very common we do a number of searches in the spring. I would say there are probably 7 to 10 searches out there going on. Not all of them are going to, some of them are searches where the superintendent has already left. Some of them are districts that are very different from you all in terms of size and demographics. So you probably won't see the same level of, or the same kinds of candidates applying for some of those jobs. Traditionally, you have, in the smaller districts, you have folks who are current assistant and associate superintendents seeking to get their first superintendency. And then you have, for the larger districts, you see folks that are more experienced and have superintendent experience. For instance, your current superintendent was an experienced superintendent before he came there. So I would expect you would see some significant experience, which is different from the pool for smaller districts generally. People generally move up in size for lots of reasons. One is that it carries a larger salary from the state, and another one is that it just is advancing your career. So I think you guys would be able to attract some good experienced superintendents. Or the other group that I think you would attract from that smaller districts would not be able to attract is assistant superintendents from large school districts whose salaries would not allow them probably to take such a cut to go to a smaller district, but would be interested in coming to a district of your size. And those would be people with great experience would be assistant superintendents in the large districts in state and out of state. And that's the pool that we generally know about out there. I think you'll be pulling different people than other districts, if you want to be honest, or different candidates, some who might not be interested in other districts. Then you have the geographic issue. I don't think there are many others looking in your area right now. There are more in the eastern part of the state, more in the northern part of the state. But you're still competing to some extent with some of them.
I don't want to keep on holding this, but since I got one other question. In your conversation that you had earlier, you were saying that we were held by law on the confidentiality of all the candidates that we discussed in closed session and all that, that is by law that we had to protect their identity. That's correct?
Yes. The only way you could deviate from that is if you got their permission to release their information. And if you ask candidates to give their permission, it is my experience that the number and quality of people in your pool will decline significantly. So even though there is a way to release names, it is not beneficial to the board to do that because experienced superintendents do not want the information out there that they may be looking for another job. It makes it very difficult for them to remain in their current districts if they do not get the job. So my experience is that that the most experienced superintendents are unlikely to want their name to be out there publicly and unwilling to apply if that's the condition.
Thank you.
Hello, Allison. This is Donnie Thurman. I noticed in your packet that you talked about advertising on multiple media. Can you give me an idea when it comes to advertising, what kind of methods would you use? How far is the reach, so to speak? Are we talking all 50 states, or are we talking a smaller pool?
Well, as I think I mentioned before, we do have a national database that we work with other state school board associations to fill up. And so when people apply for one in the 36 states that work together, if people apply, then they're also asked to fill out a profile, and they would get an email if they filled out a profile that matched your profile. So just to alert them that this is a possibility that they might be interested in. But what we do is we start with our state, and we send out an email to every single superintendent and every single human resources director in the state. And we ask them to post on their bulletin boards in the local districts the vacancies that we have. We also have a spot on our website that is a superintendent search spot that people know, even if they're not using, even boards that don't use our services, they advertise on there. And that's just a membership benefit. So people know to go looking at our website if they're interested in the state, because that's the best place to find everything. We also work through the state department. The Department of Public Instruction sends out an email to the superintendent group for us as well. So we blanket the state as much as we can. We also are working with different groups that are training aspiring superintendents. They'll advertise it for us. So we think everyone in the state who's looking knows where to look, and we can get that word out to them. Nationally, the one place we recommend you advertise is the National Association of School Administrators. that seems to reach across the country. In our experience, we see about half of our applicants from out of state and half in state. And so we believe that reaches a number of a large number of folks. That seems to be the best place to advertise. We don't recommend you advertise in a lot of other national places because it's really not necessary. And we also, you can put it on your website, but we found that targeting the trade publications gets everyone that you might want to get to. And we can talk about that if you choose to use this. We can talk about where else it might be useful. But in my early days when I was an attorney at Farrington Smith, we advertised in the newspapers, and that's not really targeting the audience that you want to target. You want to publish in trade publications and target the audience who have the certifications you need rather than just to the general public, because it requires special certifications. The job requires special training and certifications. So we believe we blanket really widely. We have reached as far as Alaska and Maine to get candidates. We even had one superintendent come to North Carolina who was from Canada. And we've had applicants from as far away as Americans who were administrators in American schools abroad in Europe and the Middle East and places like that. So we believe where we advertise reaches the broadest audience.
Allison, this is Roger Harris. I've got some procedural questions that I need to have clear in my mind. I was going to ask you about the screening process and the initial screening, but then I heard you say that you don't do screening. Even if we tell you that, for example, we're looking for someone with this certification and this educational degree, you don't screen out candidates that don't have that? Am I understanding that correctly?
Someone that may not have those criteria. So we don't want to keep information from you that folks have submitted to you. But what I said is we have this experience chart. So if you're looking for someone with superintendent experience, then we group them together. So the first group would be people with in-state superintendent experience. And then the next group would be people with out-of-state superintendent experience. So that it's clear who's who, and it's real easy for you to screen out the ones that you may not be interested in talking to, without us having to tell you who they are. We give you the tools to do it yourselves very easily.
Okay, I understand that. My second question was about, I heard you say that you would help facilitate the interviews, and then I heard you say that you don't sit in on the interviews. How do you facilitate an interview if you don't sit in on it?
Well, we do two things. One is we help you all work with drafting questions. We often recommend a presentation question that folks do. So we work with you on the questions themselves, and we have sample questions to use. So we'll come and do that, go through those with you. And then when we come to the interviews, we will help the board get in and out of closed session. We will make sure the confidentiality is preserved. We will be there in whatever building you choose to have the interviews in. We will facilitate the interviews. We just don't sit in during the actual interview, because what we don't want is for you to look at us and say, what do you think about this candidate? Or for the candidate to look at us and say, why didn't I, what did I do that didn't get me the job? This is a relationship you build between yourselves and the candidates. So we facilitate getting you in and out. We'll facilitate the discussion when you talk about next steps. We just think sitting in on the actual interviews gives the wrong impression that somehow we have a role in the decision making, when we think, again, that is by law and duty, it is yours.
Thank you. My last question is about background checks. The term background checks means different things to different people. What does a background check mean to you?
Okay. Well, we have a company, there is an additional charge to check candidates' backgrounds. We have a really great company we work with that actually works with some of the national superintendent search firms doing their background. They do criminal and credit checks and also education credential checks. So it's as thorough of a check as we've been able to find. And they're actually based out of Durham, but they're very good, and as I said, they work nationally. So criminal credit and education verification checks is what the service does. We do the reference checking. We have contacts with every school system in the state and every state in the country. And what we do is call references on your behalf or work with you for, to get other information that you want to get. As part of the application process, we also get licensure and a university transcripts, and they submit those, and then we verify that they're accurate with their universities, etc. But we try to be very thorough. We have a very long interview process when we usually take about an hour per reference with each candidate. We do not just check the references that they give us. We check the people who we believe will be honest with us. And I think one of the benefits of using us is that we help all of our boards, and I can say to a board of education, when I help you with your next search, you would want me to be, you would want me to have good reference checking. So it's very important you be honest with me and tell me what was really going on with this person, if there's an issue. And they, we get really good information. Again, we have contacts all the same. I do this, you know, most of the time. So I think we're very well plugged in and can get good information that they might be reluctant to tell someone they don't know.
Allison, hi, this is Richard Hooker. You have partially answered my question. I wanted to inquire about some of your intangibles. You highlighted some of the services and the benefit that you provide, and of course, many of those services and the benefits are well documented and very impressive in many areas. And you, of course, mentioned one of the benefits that could be somewhat of an intangible, which is the question that I want to ask with respect to, you know, the effective process of reference checks. And you have also have a good track record with superintendents that have been selected by respective districts that have become national superintendents of the year and state superintendents of the year. And I think those qualities are very impressive. And so I was just trying to, if you were willing to divulge, what other intangibles or qualitative benefits that you provide that other than those that have already been documented?
Well, I think I think some of the things I've said are intangibles in that we have relationships with every school board and every superintendent in the state. So if we're looking to check references, I feel like they're comfortable being honest with me, and they know I will protect the integrity of their information. But also that if I'm helping them, that they would want me to have that same access. So I think that's great. We have this national relationship. As many of you know, I'm currently chair of the National Council of School Attorneys for the nation. And as part of that, I sit on the board of directors of the National School Boards Association as an ex officio member. And so I am working with people all across the country, very close to the National School Boards Association staff and also the board of directors. I am very proud of the fact that many of the superintendents we have helped boards find are well-respected members of their profession. In fact, as I think I said, we had like three out of the last five state superintendents of the year, and the current national superintendent of the year are people that we have helped their boards find. So we feel like we have access to great candidates, great information, very well plugged in. I also think people respect us. I think we're a very well-respected service. And I would, again, if you call your neighboring districts that we provided you information about, I think you will find that those boards felt like we provided them a really strong service. And we're also, we know you, and we really care about you. We exist to help boards of education, and we're very passionate about what we do. And we're here to make sure that you feel taken care of, supported, in your most important role. I mean, that's something we really treasure. And I will tell you, my staff and I, we love what we do, and we will pour our hearts into it. And those are the intangibles I can think of off the top of my head.
Hi, Allison, it's Shara. Talk just a little bit about the community and staff input. I know it's an online survey, and then you've got public comments. I guess, should we at a board meeting take public comments, or do we just depend on the online survey? And is this a survey, kind of a generic template that y'all use, or all school systems? I guess I should just go back to talk about that just a little bit.
We have several surveys. One is a very generic survey that a lot of boards use because it's the simplest one. But we have some very more complex surveys that have people rating different characteristics and that kind of thing. We can do whatever your board thinks would be most helpful. The more generic survey will get you more people who take it. The more in-depth survey will provide you with more in-depth information. But remember what a survey is. It's not a scientific survey. It is anyone who in your community or on your staff who wants to comment can do so and provide input to the board. I do think it's very helpful for your community and staff to have an opportunity to speak their minds about their concerns. And I think it's helpful for the board to listen to that. I also think what we do after the surveys is we work with the board to develop the board's profile that is informed by the surveys, because if you do it before you get the surveys, then they're not as relevant to the board's decision-making process. So we'll do that before you see the applications. We'll work with the board on a profile that is based on, in part, the information received from the surveys. But back to your question, we used to suggest community forums, and a lot of boards used to hold them. Our experience is that with the online survey, not very many people show up, especially if it's wintertime and it's cold, but not very many people show up to comment, and a lot of people don't feel comfortable getting up in front of a group and speaking their mind. And a lot of people don't have time to, you know, or don't believe they have the time to come to a board meeting. But we do get a lot more response with surveys. And we do a separate staff and community survey with the same questions generally, so you can really see the difference between what your staff is thinking about and what your community is thinking about on the same line. And that's interesting to compare and contrast what the concerns of the staff are versus the community. So that's kind of what we do, but the survey is something you all can alter. I mean, we have three or four different kinds that we use, and you guys can make choices about what you like and whether you want to edit it, and boards do that all the time. So again, it's your process. We're here to give you some guides, some beginning places, but not to tell you what it should be, but to let you make choices.
Also on that, if we went with the timeline number two, the shorter timeline, for that part of the process, you've got roughly 4 weeks. Is that the minimum amount of time that we should give for the survey, or is that a way to reclaim a week or so to help shorten our timeline, or should we leave it at?
I think that a month is plenty of time for the survey. Really what we're going on is the application deadline that's the 6 to 8 weeks, and the shorter timeline is April 7th. If you'll notice that the meeting to report on surveys would be a week after the application deadline. It usually takes us about a week to process those, so we would bring those with us if you're looking at April 14th. Again, we can move this time up if you all want to get started next week. This presumes starting 2 weeks from now. So we can squeeze time if you want to get started earlier.
So would we have to leave the 4 weeks for the survey, or could we make that 3 weeks? Would that help?
It's three. There's no magical time. I think truthfully, when you put a survey information out, you need a little bit of time for the word to get out there. Yeah. But after a while, people forget about it. So you get the most responses
in the first 2 weeks, I would think. But so we wouldn't be hurting.
3 weeks would be sufficient.
Okay. Allison, the microphone's come back around to me again, and I have another question. This is my first superintendent search, or whatever. I realize it is a very important decision, but you mentioned a couple of things as the microphone went around, that I want to make sure I understand. As we're interviewing candidates, and you mentioned wherever you choose to interview those, how do we as a board, could you step me through the process if we're going to interview at a certain location? As a board, do we have to go into an open session or closed session to do this? And do we have to notify the media that we're doing these interviews? Because that could also put those candidates at risk of of opening those up. Could you just address that a little bit for me to clarify, make sure I understand?
We are used to this issue. Yes, you have to notify the press and the public where you'll be having your meetings. Many times they are held at hotels, so that there's a lot coming and going, and we can adequately protect the confidentiality. A lot of times you'll go into closed session, convene the meeting, go to closed session in the lobby, and then have a meeting room elsewhere. So that's a pretty common scenario, again, to protect the confidentiality of the applicant's identity, but also to honor the open meetings requirements. So there, yes, you would have to publish it as an open meeting with the only agenda item being a closed session for personnel, and then duly go into closed session and let people know where you are. I mean, well, you know, it depends on what you have available in your community, but most boards meet in a hotel where there's adequate meeting space and some ability to preserve that confidentiality.
Allison, this is Danny Blanton. I'm going to want to go back to that background check. This could be, I'm wondering if this was involved in that. I'd like to know that if in that background check, does that go back and tell us how that superintendent done on their testing in their district they were, how they associated with the teachers, principals, and the media or everybody? That's my first question.
Well, one of the things we do when we send the applications to you is we do pull down the testing data from the school district that individual is coming from. So that's part of what you get right up front, in addition to the internet searches and the other things that we provide to you. So that's something that's important to you. In terms of the asking how folks relate to teachers and other folks within their school districts, that's information that you can get out of their references, and if those questions are important to you as a board, then we can ask the references specific questions, and you can help us design the reference questions that we ask so that those questions are addressed.
That definitely be a good question that I'd like to know how they get along, and how will do we get the candidates coming to us? Do they know a salary or a contract somewhere in the baseline on the caliber of our size of our school to what we know that what we've got getting applications for, what he's going to be looking at?
We have put together a chart. As you know, it's public information what everybody in the entire school district makes is their salary. So we get the information from the Department of Public Instruction about what every superintendent of the state makes. They have that information. They publish it as every year, and they publish it as a monthly amount. We take that and we convert it into an annual amount, and sort those that information by size so that you can see how you are paying your superintendent in relation to other districts of similar size. That information is also available to the candidates, so they will know what your current salary is, and also on our chart has what the state provides to you in terms of their share of this, and what the range of state monies is available to you. So that's something we provide through the process to you all, the candidates who ask for it, so that they can know what the salary range is. So I don't necessarily recommend boards decide what their salary is going to be ahead of time. A lot of that's going to depend on your candidate is, whether they're an experienced superintendent and you really want to bring them in and you're willing to pay them a little more, or whether it's an assistant superintendent who's willing to accept a little less. Those are kind of conversations you have depending on who you're targeting to hire.
So it won't be based on what we're doing now, or it'll be based on that candidate, right?
Well, you have a certain amount of money available to you from the state that would factor into what you're going to offer. You're also required to pay a certain amount of state dollars to whomever you hire within a certain range, but you have some flexibility in deciding what you are willing to pay depending on who you want to hire and what it takes to get them to come there.
Thank you. Allison, this is Jerry Hall. I'm also a board member. This will be my first time in going through this process, and Question I have is, it mentions the board reviews the applications, and with a search like this, if we do a search like you would recommend, what kind of number of applications would you be expecting? What kind of range of applications would you be expecting us to look at?
Okay, I'm told the national average is about 12. We generally see a little bit more than that. I would say for your district, somewhere between 15 and 20. If we get above 20, we would think that would be a really high number. But we're usually happy when we get to 15. Remember, these are people with very specific qualifications. So I'm lowballing it a little because I don't want to get your hooks up, but 20 is, you know, is a good number, and we rarely see, especially these days, I'm not seeing a ton more than that. But the key is to get some really solid people. You only need one really, really good one. I think ultimately that's what you want, but you want some good people to choose among. And so we're hoping to find those for you when you do your search. But 15 to 20 is probably reasonable.
Okay, and then you mentioned that the board looks at the application and then narrows it down to 7 to 10 for an interview.
Yes.
Okay.
That's and it may not be that many. If you, you know, it depends on, and some boards don't choose to interview that many, but we think that's a good ballpark.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Comments? Well, Allison, how would you like for us to proceed? Would you like to stay on board while we discuss a little bit and decide, and or would you rather I call you tomorrow morning or what?
You can call me tomorrow morning or later tonight if you want to stay. Okay. We'd be delighted. If you don't, we certainly understand, and we're here to support you in any way we can. But as I said, you know, our passion is to work with boards and to help them do this sort of thing, and so we would be delighted if you chose us. But I'm just going to let go so you guys can feel like you can have an open conversation. And if you want to call me back later in the meeting or tomorrow morning or whatever, please feel free. Okay?
And we really appreciate you coming. I think I speak on behalf of everybody.
Sorry to be here in person, but it was iffy with the weather, so we all decided it was better for me to do it this way. Thank you very much for your time this evening.
And stay warm. Thank you. Bye. Thank you, Cheryl. That was excellent. Good trial run for somebody like me who might be away from the meeting sometime. It's no trial run.
No, you can't be away.
Oh. Well, floor's open for discussion. What do you all think? I guess, first of all, what method should we go about with the search?
She said the first question we had to ask is do we do a search?
Well, that's included.
Yeah. I think we need to do a search. We certainly got good candidates within Cleveland County, but I think it would be in our best interest to conduct a search. The best candidate may be in Boardman Springs, or the best candidate may be in Baltimore, Maryland. We don't know yet because we've not looked. So I would encourage the board to conduct a nationwide search to see the best candidate for the children of Cleveland County.
I agree.
Anybody in disagreement? Do we need to take a vote on that?
I think it would be in order. I
think, Mr. Chairman, do you care to make a motion?
I would like to make a motion that we go on that. Let me back up, because is it to select or is it just to?
This is to just conduct the search.
Okay, conduct the search. Okay, because I'm getting a little ahead of myself. But yes, I'd like
rather
to make a
motion do it in-house.
That the
or rather than
yes.
To hire in-house, but to conduct the search and the best person involved.
Yes, I would like to make a motion that we do conduct the search so that we can explore and investigate and look for the best candidate available, whether internally or externally.
Is there a second? It's been moved in multiple 4 seconds.
Yes.
Any discussion?
I think it's really important that we do the best job we can to locate the best superintendent for the school system for our students. I think we owe it to them to look all over to find that best person that's going for our school system. And I think a search is the best way to do that.
Any other discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes unanimously. Now, on to the next. Who does the search? Do we do it in-house? Or do we hire a private group? Or do we go with the... If my understanding is correct, I mean, it would be foolish to try another state school board association, because and ours are really restricted to North Carolina, so I'm assuming Tennessee and Virginia and Wisconsin, they're all, you know, doing similar searches within for only their people. So I think those are the three options. Open for discussion after hearing Ms. Schaefer's presentation.
Well, I think she mentioned that Charlotte did an outside search, and the costs were upwards to $80,000+. And I looked at some data showing that the costs are significantly more than what they're going to be charging. So I think they have probably the best process we can look for. And I, for one, think that they do a good job with it. From what I see, what they offer. Now, doing it in-house, I looked at that option as well. We'd almost have to have another person dedicated solely to that cause, which would probably get up into the, you know, to a high range as well. I mean, we're going to have somebody booking flights and making arrangements and doing all this and that. Whenever we can let them, I think they're a one-stop shop, so to speak. They can do it all. And I would offer my support to allowing NCSBA to do the search.
I feel the same way, if I might say my opinion, based on previous experience twice in years gone by. They put down the Cleveland County school system, merged system, and the old Shelby system, too. But I also think there's another thing. If we did it in-house, we'd almost have to spend a lot of money for our attorneys, to tell you, to keep us straight, or at least keep me straight, and to also explain the ins and outs. Like somebody asked about how we did the meeting, you know, how we did the open-closed bit with it. So I'm all in favor of Pam.
Now, I did understand her correct. Now, she will interview our in-house people or out-of-town people, wherever. It don't matter where they come from. They interview
right,
everybody.
That's right.
Well, they'll get a
group. No,
they don't interview, but they'll get the group together. That's in-house and everything.
They accept applications.
Okay. Yeah, anybody can apply.
And check references and so forth, you know. And I like the idea. I didn't realize that they called up who they strategically, or who they felt would give them the honest answers. You know? And so,
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to, you know, we've used it before, and I was on the board when we used it the last time, and very pleased with the School Board Association. And with that, I'd like to make a motion that we use the North Carolina School Board Association for the search process.
Thank you. Any second?
Second.
Second, again, multiple. So, any further discussion? It's been moved that we contract with the State School Board Association to facilitate our search.
One quick observation in support of the motion and second is that you know, you vote not on favoritism, you vote on performance. And the School Board Association has shown and demonstrated performance that has been recommended and applauded by several school districts. And I think that's the basis of our decision, is based on their performance.
Any further discussion?
Are we
going to
try to move this timeline up, as she said? Okay,
all right,
let's vote on the motion.
There being no further discussion on the motion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passes unanimously. Now to perhaps the most difficult part, and I'll let you carry on, Ms. Foss.
I just would like to get up here as quickly as possible
to do that, then she pretty well shortened it by 1 week automatically, mm-hmm. I think.
And she said we could shorten it
some of those.
And some of the other places.
But I don't think we have to decide that necessarily tonight.
No.
I do think we need to decide on.
A meeting for next week.
A call meeting next week. Yes.
All right. Are we going to be able to get the public participation in this within this next week?
No, that, we don't do that then. That would take place after next week. Next week, we would need to find, and of course, it's going to depend on her schedule too. When she, you know, it's kind of like tonight, because, and it sounded like she wanted to be here for that meeting. And so we would meet with her to set the timelines and so forth next week. And then we decide when that community input, when that part of the process will begin. So
she's got that down for April 14th. We possibly can move that up. Is that not right?
Community and staff is February 28th or March 31st. That's what I was asking. Could that be shortened to 3 weeks instead of 4 weeks? And it automatically will start earlier if we get started next week. So then they'll get the surveys ready, and then we can advertise that the surveys are online. So that,
now she did say, I don't know if I'm the only one heard it, but she did say after we voted if we wanted to call her back to set up a meeting for next week, we would do so. Look at you. y'all just tell me when you want to meet, but I guess there again we can't just set a meeting if we don't know if she's available.
Well, we can do it another way, though.
Okay.
Is anybody not available Monday through Thursday next week?
And then you just
nobody's going to meet on Friday.
Well, if it took it, I would do it.
Well,
I'd say you contact her after the meeting privately and just find out what her schedule is and work through her and let us know.
I'll call her on the way home. She gave me her cell phone number.
And we're talking evenings next week?
I don't I was thinking that, but that was out of respect, really, for the working people, you two sitting together. Let's see. Oh, Richard. Yeah, Richard.
Richard's got a good job.
We got to be careful.
Where do you go? Mr.
I don't prefer evenings, and I'm available in
evening. Well, I think just hearing everybody's going to make a special effort to be available whenever she can.
It's going to depend on what she can work out of her.
But I don't think she would have said it that way if she weren't available sometime.
Yeah.
Right. And she seems to love to drive the way she was talking, because she told me if she had not gotten an email about 6 o'clock this morning from her boss, who's Ed Dunlap, who said, "I will not allow you to be on the road tonight," she would have been here tonight. So anybody else? Donnie, you had your.
I was going to just say it's, I'm definitely, up for whatever day we need to do it. I did want to make an observation. I like the way they do the surveys. I think that's going to be a great method. But I would also like to see public comment be included. I think one of her concerns were, I think she said there may be a lack of participation. And, people just don't come to meetings like that. I would just like to see public comment, be included in our process, because I, for one, don't think there'll be a lack of participation. I think we probably have to control how much participation we want and put some limits on it, because I think people need to be heard physically as well as online. Some people aren't going to have access to online methods, and I think it would be good to see people in person and hear what the community has to say, just to get a pulse on what they have to do. So whatever route we choose to take on that, I'd just like to mention that I'm strongly in favor of that.
And I second that.
Any other comments on that?
I agree. It's a good idea. And obviously we can't get into a dialogue with community members, but opening up a forum where they can come and tell us what they hope that we look for in a candidate. I mean, you're going to get some generic things, get some of those children and that kind of thing. But you're going to get some specific things that we may not have thought of. And online surveys are good in that it helps participation. But you're answering particular questions, usually with little drop downs, and you're choosing this and that, and that does limit your ability to really say what's on your heart. So I think Donnie did me right. Some community forums,
travel, one in the county, one in the other. That'd be okay with me to travel some.
And during, and all these dates it has in there, public comment on that community.
Yeah, and I like, and I'm just saying that because I think she recommended, because sometimes, you know, some districts don't get the turnout that they're expecting. Mm-hmm. I think we definitely get the turnout. And I just wanted to be said that we as a board did everything possible to include the community in this process. And I think, you know, once we open the door, even if two people show up, at least we open the door to do what we said we would do.
Yeah, I like the idea of what Roger said. I think we might need to travel.
I wouldn't mind seeing one at Burns, one at Crest, and one at Kings Mountain. All three places have, and I'm available. Mr. Hooker, you know, he has to work. And Ms. Miller, Donnie, they have to work a little bit. But we can do it at night. They don't have to work at night.
She's had experience.
She'll be able to give us some direction.
I think she could give us a little ideas. For example, you know, we have to have some rules. We couldn't let somebody speak for an hour.
Right.
And in my experience, Richard, you were there years ago when the old Shelby system went to an intermediate school. We had a forum over at Jefferson School, and I guess I learned a little bit from that lesson. And at 11, it started at 7, and at 11 o'clock, the final person, the lady, got up and there was a bunch there. They said the same thing over and over and over again. And she got up there and she said the same thing. But then she added, said, "It's just awful to come. You board members have already made up your mind." And I just, as gentle as Lee Gilly is, I just blurted out spontaneously. I said, "Ma'am, we're not the ones with the closed mind here." And she didn't like it, you know. And later, I saw her at a party where I was invited to one time, and she was greeting people at the door, my wife and I walked in. But she was real nice, but I'm telling you, it can get out of hand.
I would suggest, and I'm not opposed to it, but I think there would need to be good ground rules, but I would suggest releasing an online survey, getting that out there for a few weeks first, giving people that opportunity, and then if we need to hold one or two forums, I think that gives people the opportunity to handle it either way, and that way, because we also don't want to hope people will be respectful enough to say something derogatory against our current superintendent also, because I think people just need to be respectful, and I think that while we do need to give people the opportunity to let us know how they feel, I think a lot of that will be heard through online surveys if we give that a chance to work and then hold a meeting or two.
Yes, sir.
We could get somebody to mediate, in other words, and do a guideline. In other words, have one in the upper end, one over here, and one, like I say, if we have three of them, let somebody mediate the word that it's going on. Those are the rules and guidelines, and not get out of hand. Maybe, you know, some individual that someone knows.
And we also need to keep the timeline in mind, too. That,
all right.
You know, if we're going to try to get this completed before June 30th, we can't spend a couple of months.
We have to do it by July, right.
And so we will need to keep that in mind, because I don't think it would be fair to hold any of those meetings where everyone could not be present, because I think we would all need to. And so it's going to be a little dicey.
We need to do it before the deadline of application, because we take that input that people might would give to help make decisions on who we'd hire.
Yeah, but what Ms. Miller is saying is we shouldn't let all of this interfere with our ultimate goal. In other words, we got to fit it all in to make our goal of hiring a new superintendent to go on board July 1st. Now, we might not make it, but we got to strive for that.
I think this is just a sample.
Right.
We're going to come up with our own next week when we meet with Allison if it's scheduled.
The only real definitive date on there is whatever we work out for next week. And hopefully she can tell me tonight, and I'll email you. Don't necessarily wait up for it tonight, but it'll be there tomorrow morning.
Okay.
A question on the possibility that we may not have a superintendent by August 1st. I know the first two calendars she gave us, but neither one of those have a date that early. And certainly I would love to have one by July 1. But what is the process if we don't have a superintendent named then? Name an acting superintendent? Is that the procedure?
I think that's what it would be, but I think it's what we would decide. And I'm not sure we're ready to decide that just yet. I mean, I think we should be thinking about it, you know, but probably have a plan B, as you what you're saying.
Well, things just like with the weather tonight, things do have a tendency sometimes to get in the way, and things slip and things happen, and certainly I don't want us to rush the process to the point of making an unwise decision in the haste to bring somebody on board on July 1. And if it takes an extra month to find the best candidate, then let's not be hesitant to take the time it takes to get a good candidate.
Before we leave, I would like, Dr. Boyles, could you help us a little bit with, should we recess this to another meeting time set in the future, or should we just wait and tomorrow make another call meeting?
You have the ability to make call an emergency meeting for a reason, and of course it would be, you can call a meeting within 48 hours notice.
Without being emergent?
Yes.
Right.
So you can call, I mean, I would say it would be appropriate to adjourn this meeting and call another meeting.
Okay.
While I'm sorry, I got the floor, I'll just tell you also I don't have to send an email. We're closed. So.
I'm glad you didn't turn the power off tonight.
You don't turn the heat off. You don't turn the heat off.
Ms. Hoare. Oh, I thought your old man Roger said something. Okay, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
Move
to
adjourn.
Second. Second. All in favor, say aye.
Thank you. Hold on, man.